as he spoke to that good thief, inviting him to see the fullness of who he was by stepping back into paradise without any brokenness, without any sin, to see his beauty. Then he pauses for a moment and speaks this third word from the cross, from John's Gospel. And then Jesus looked down. He saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby. And then he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to his disciple, "Behold your mother." From that hour, the disciple took Mary into his own home. "Woman, behold your son." Emptying is what Jesus does so beautifully to show us. Emptying from Philippians 2, "He who did not deem equality with God something to be grasped at, but rather emptied himself to be a servant in the form of a man." But not only that, to become sin, and not only that, but to die. But not only that, in these last moments of his life, he continues to give everything away. Gives away his dignity at the scourging. Gives away his friends in the garden. Gives away his clothes that the guards strip away. And now gives away his mother in love. What a beautiful image for you and for me. It's all about Jesus' compassion once again. What is it like when someone you love is dying? What was Mary feeling at this point watching her son? She's human. We put her on a pedestal. She was a mother and fully human. So she had to stand there and watch as her son suffered death. As a hospital chaplain, that was my worst times. To watch a mother hold a hand of a child in a room and know that there was not going to be a healing grace. And to cry with them. And to hurt with them. And to know that a parent never, ever believes that they're going to bury their child. Ever. Mary's no different. And Jesus knows her heart right now. And he knows that she needs someone to share this grief with. And so he pushes the young guy, John, the youngest disciple at 14 or 15, into the arms of his mother. "Behold your mother. Take care of her. Hold her. Let her cry. You cry with her." And Mary, even though she understood she was part of this salvation story, that the angel told her that something like this would happen. My dear brothers and sisters, she's human. She's a mother. It's her son. And so she has to stand there with a faith that she's not quite understanding. The same kind of faith that you and I sometimes need when the worst things happen, the biggest tragedies, the deepest hurts, illnesses we can't get over, aging creeps up on us and slows us down. Mary understands in one way, but as a mother, she can't look beyond the cross yet. She only believes that something good will come out of this. Can we do that tonight? Whatever tragedy enters our life, whatever difficulty, whatever circumstance pulls us down, can you and I believe, like the Blessed Mother, that there's something beyond the cross? Something beyond that horrible scene that she's seeing as a mother losing a child. She believes, even though she doesn't see. That's not always easy. But I've come to understand that blessings arrive even though I don't see them. That if I have faith, Jesus makes things change into Easter, even when I somehow doubt it. But I know one thing. Blessings are always coming to you and to me. And that's what Mary held on to, even in her grief. There was a blessing beyond this tragedy for her. God wouldn't tell her. keep the promise. Amen? And for us, it's the same. I don't care what the tragedy is. If we have this kind of faith, the worst of the worst becomes filled with the greatest blessing. St. Paul says boldly, "In my moments of weakness, God, your power reaches its perfection." Let's pray that we believe that as we hear this prayer and recognize this what we have to do. Jesus, help us to follow your mother's example, living obediently even in the midst of her deepest hurt. Help us love and believe in the promise of your Father, and experience the same kind of trust that Mary showed at the foot of your cross. Help us through every trial, every difficulty, every loss. We know that you will always